Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2023. This morning we will continue our inquiry into long COVID, and I would like to welcome to the meeting Ewan Dick, Head of the Chief Scientist's Office, Professor Dame Anna Dominicek, the Chief Scientist for Health at the Chief Scientist's Office, Professor Chris Robertson, Professor of Public Health Epidemiology at the University of Strathclyde, and Professor Kay Cooper, Clinical Professor of Allied Health Professions at Robert Gordon University and NHS Grampian. We also have Professor Edward Duncan from the Nursing Midwifery and Allied Health Professions Research Unit at the University of Stirling, and Dr. Janet Scott, who is a consultant in infectious diseases for NHS Highlands, as well as an affiliate senior clinical lecturer at the MRC University of Glasgow Centre for Virus Research, who joins us online. Good morning and thank you for giving us your time this morning. We estimate that this session will run up to about 20 to 11, and each member will probably have about 12 minutes each to speak to the panel and to ask questions. For Janet, who is attending remotely this morning, if you'd like to respond to an issue being discussed, please type R in the chat box and we'll bring you in. I'm keen that everybody gets an opportunity to speak, and I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses just in the interest of brevity. If I could ask the witnesses just to briefly introduce themselves and the work they've been doing, and I'll start with yourself, Dr. Janet Scott, because you're online with me this morning.
Thanks. Do you want just a brief introduction at this point, or
yes.
So I'm Janet Scott. I actually just started yesterday in Inverness. I'm a consultant in infectious disease and clinical pharmacology at Ragmore Hospital. I'm part of the long COVID team here and principal investigator of the locomotion study. I'm also an affiliate senior clinical lecturer at the Centre for Virus Research in Glasgow, where I've been working up until now, where I've been studying post-viral conditions since 2015.
Thank you very much, Dr. Scott. Can I bring in Ewan Dick, please?
Thank you. Yeah, my name's Ewan Dick and I head up the Chief Scientist's Office, which is part of the Director General for Health and Social Care within the Scottish Government. And our responsibilities are to look after health, research, development and innovation within the NHS in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in Professor Dame Anna Dominicek? Sorry, I hope I'm pronouncing you
perfectly. Dominicek, thank you. So my name is Anna Dominicek. I am a relatively new chief scientist for health in Scottish Government, working with UN and Chief Scientist Office. I started in this role on 1st of July 2022, so 6 months in the role. My background is that I'm also a Regius Chair of Medicine at the University of Glasgow. So this is a seconded role, and my research and clinical work has been in cardiovascular medicine and cardiovascular prevention over the last 25 plus years in Glasgow.
Thank you very much. And can I bring in Professor Kay Cooper, please?
Thank you. Yes, I'm Kay Cooper. I'm a clinical professor of Allied Health Professions, which is a joint post based across Robert Gordon University at Aberdeen and NHS Grampian. So I'm a physiotherapist by background, but I'm really an applied health researcher. My field of research is quite varied, largely to date on self-management of chronic conditions. And I'm jointly leading a study that's looking at evaluating emerging models of rehabilitation for community rehabilitation for people with long COVID, along with my colleague here.
Thank you, Professor Cooper. And can I bring in Professor Edward Duncan?
Thank you very much and good morning. My name's Edward Duncan. I'm Professor of Applied Health Research at the University of Stirling in the Chief Scientist's Office Research Unit for Nurses, Midwives and Allied Health Professionals. And together with Kay, with Professor Cooper, we're leading the study of looking at different models of service delivery for rehabilitation in long COVID research.
Thank you very much. And Professor Chris Robertson.
Oh, hello there. I'm Chris Robertson. I'm a statistician by trade, working in the Maths and Stats Department at Strathclyde University. I have a joint appointment within Public Health Scotland. For the last three, 4 years, I've been working on a big study of electronic health records within Scotland, the EVE study, and in terms of long COVID, I've been working on the CSO-funded long COVID study using electronic health records from GP data in Scotland.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move to questions now from members, and I'll ask Murdo Fraser to please come in.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if I could start off with a question, probably it's best directed to yourself, Professor De Manna, or to you and Dick from the Chief Scientist's Office about the research you've been funding looking into long COVID. And I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about how you've taken decisions about the areas in which you will fund research and what you view as the priority areas for research to be done.
Could I just ask all the research or within the topic of today's discussion?
No, only within the topic of long COVID. Yeah.
On long COVID, yeah. Yes. So before I started, and Ewan will add to this, so in late 2020, so relatively early, there was a call for long COVID research. And as we described in our written response, there were 35 excellent applications. They were assessed by expert panel as normally chaired by independent chair and with number of experts in the area, and 9 projects have been funded. These projects are still in progress. We have described the projects, and people who have contributed are here with us today. This was very early days of long COVID, so the projects focused at that stage on descriptive research of describing the prevalence, the symptoms, multiple symptomatology that really includes all organs, all systems in the body. But there were also, as we already heard, efforts to assess rehabilitation, 2 projects, and very interesting projects, including the one published, as it happens, or maybe not yet published, but available to us all to look in the Lancet, the project of data linkage. So these projects have been selected by expert panel, and from what we see so far, majority of them have not yet achieved final report. This will happen and will be available online on our website when it's ready. Mm-hmm. But from what we see so far, the linkage studies, the rehabilitation work have been very well chosen and extremely useful.
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. And we do have your written submissions with some more detail on the projects that you are funding. Can you tell us anything about emerging findings at this stage? Are there any themes that are coming through that you've seen so far from the research that's being done?
So I think mentioned previously EVE2, I think what we have, what's been released on the Lancet at the moment pre-final review study is exceptional because it looked at 5.1 million adult Scots. I'm not aware of previous linkage of that size and that power and potential. So I think extremely exciting to see that such linkage is possible, and also that it would be possible to repeat it long term, to review that the linkage platform has happened, and my colleague on far right will be much more expert on describing this. So EVE2 provided a platform that can now be used. This linkage can be repeated as a follow-up of what's happening in Scotland regarding long COVID. I think extremely interesting. The same with colleagues on my left and the rehabilitation. We now know what's happening across Scotland in all 14 boards in all 14 territorial boards. So we have a baseline. We wouldn't have known this without early stage results from this particular study. So very useful things have happened. There was another smaller linkage study performed by colleagues in Glasgow, Professor Jill Pell and colleagues, also CSO funded, which looked in very interesting way longitudinally, 6, 12, 18 months. So I think we already see useful work, but it isn't finished. We need to wait for final reports of all 9 studies, and only then we can really have a full assessment of what's been produced. Ewan, would you like to add to this?
I think you've covered that very well, Anna. I think that that point that you just made at the end there, that we're awaiting the final reports and the peer-reviewed articles before conclusions will be made from the findings from the studies.
Okay, thank you. And just one more question on this before I move on. Are there any gaps in areas of research that you think you need to address looking at future funding rounds?
There are always gaps in research. That's what research is all about. I think it's clear to me, and this is not me as chief scientist health, this is me as a clinician with years of experience. We need to understand the mechanism of disease. Potentially, there is more than one mechanism. That's what's coming out internationally. We need to find biomarkers that would allow to stratify patients and come with treatments that truly address, that's the precision medicine in it, treatments that truly address the underpinning mechanism, which might be different in different groups of patients. There is still a lot to do, but it will be done as an international effort rather than our own local effort. It has to be part of international work.
Okay, thanks very much. That's very helpful. I wonder if I can move on to a slightly different topic and ask a question to Professor Cooper and Professor Duncan, because I was very interested to read in your written submission your comment around self-management strategies for people with long COVID. And you suggest in your submission the evidence base for the effectiveness of these is limited. And you say your study found that people who present for assessment with long COVID rehabilitation are considered unsuitable for self-management. That's quite interesting because it does reflect some of the feedback we as a committee have had from long COVID sufferers. And I wonder if you could just elaborate a little bit on what your research has been telling you in this field.
You can go first.
So I go first, then Kay can feed in. So there has obviously been a great evidence, a great importance given to funding self-management strategies, in part to make interventions accessible to as wide a group of people as possible, and that's to be commended. And research for self-management per se out with long COVID is fairly well established for people with long-term conditions. So as a baseline way forward, there's logic to do that and logic to see that. I think self-management though has to be seen within the context of a wider breadth of rehabilitation therapies on offer to people. And in one of our case study sites in particular, where probably the most well-developed rehabilitation service for people with long COVID, where they triage people to self-management, to individualised therapies and to group therapies, they have found that very few of the people who have been referred to their services have been applicable for the self-management strategies. So it has begs a question to us as to how appropriate that is as a sole means of therapeutic offer, if you like, for people with quite complex needs.
I think that sums it up really nicely. It's the only thing I would add, it's and it links to the sort of looking at how appropriate, who's appropriate for self-management. So what we're not saying, our written response shouldn't be interpreted as nobody with long COVID is suitable for self-management, but there perhaps needs to be more research and evaluation done on how do you work out who is most appropriate for that and who needs the more complex sort of multidisciplinary or professionally led rehabilitation services, and also what are the outcomes for people who do go down the self-management route. Sure. Is that fulfilling their needs in terms of quality of life and symptom management?
So what you're saying is that you've done some research, but you're only skimmed the surface in effect. There's a lot more work needs done in this field.
Yeah. We have emerging findings that around this topic, but yes, we haven't fully evaluated it.
The breadth of delivery of self-management really would ask the question of effectiveness of that. So longer-term follow-up of is that meeting patients' needs, are there other needs not being met, would be highly valuable.
Thank you very much. I'll hand back to the convener.
Thank you very much, Meadow. Can I please move on to Alex Rowley?
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Could I look at future research? Because in the responses that we have had as a committee, there has been suggestions, to look at the implications, for example, with COVID on NHS workers in the longer term. And we've heard from NHS workers in many senses who are being impacted now. So there's suggestions there. There's many written submissions that have suggested, for example, treatment trials need to start now with existing medications. And I suppose, therefore, in terms of further research, how do you prioritise research? And are there any plans for commissioning further research in Scotland? Because the long COVID Scotland told us that in 2020, 9 research projects were funded in Scotland, but there has not been any further funding for Scottish research projects since. So given there's a lot of suggestions around what needs to be researched, how do you prioritise and do you have any plans? Will we kick off with Dame Anna?
OK. So this is a difficult question. For any research system anywhere in the world. So during 2020-21, there was no other research, and therefore research was commissioned. All our universities and all clinician scientists in universities and NHS completely moved to COVID research. They didn't do any other research, and it was appropriate to commission research. Under normal circumstances, we do not do it, or very rarely do it. And there are 2 standing committees funded by Chief Scientist Office, Health Improvement Protection and Services Research Committee and Translational Clinical Studies Research Committee. And these 2 committees are open for any long COVID or any research to come. And the researchers across Scotland are very aware. And in fact, there's been recent project, large project accepted there and funded, but it's not yet signed up, so we can't quite talk about it yet. But it will be on the website once everything is signed up. So this is open. But I think it's also important to say that the majority of research, health research, clinical research, public health research in Scotland is funded by other sources, not locally by Scottish funding. So what we do is we empower and inform all our stakeholders across Scotland very proactively about opportunities with UKRI, UK Research and Innovation, Medical Research Council, National Institutes for Health and Care Research, where our clinician scientists have been very successful. For example, in NIHR, National Institute for Health and Care Research, there were Scottish projects funded to very large sums of money that are currently in progress. So what we've been doing is we've been bringing chief executives or medical directors from this UK-wide funding bodies that have very substantial funding for our researchers to be aware of opportunities. And this is ongoing. The same is true about major charities that also fund COVID research, such as British Heart Foundation and others. So I think we do everything to make sure that Scotland and Scottish clinicians, scientists and public health researchers get optimum access to funding for long COVID and everything else. But we do not normally prioritise what they should be applying for. Okay. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Does anybody else want to add anything to that?
If you would like, just to re-emphasise some of Anna's really helpfully made points, that and to refer back to our first answer as well, you know, in normal times we run two research committees that Anna's mentioned, and those committees contain expert scientific advice that advise us on the best projects to fund that meet the needs of the people of Scotland. And as Anna said, we work within a wide international and UK system where there's a range of funders that are accessible for Scottish research projects. And they work in a very similar way to us, that they have these expert committees to help us make sure that we're funding the research that's going to have the most impact in the long term. So our prioritisation is through those committees for studies that come to us based on that expert advice. And that's what we have done for many, many years. I think the COVID situation obviously was a little bit of a different situation. And as Anna said, at that time, the NHS had stopped quite a lot of research and it wasn't feasible to start research in other conditions, which is why we focused particularly on a condition that was emerging. So it was quite an unusual time that we did that in.
Could I ask, therefore, in terms of this question about previous research, what struck me in terms is long COVID started to emerge and people started to highlight that they were suffering from it, was that I started to receive a lot of emails from people who have suffered for years with ME and drawn comparisons with a lot of the conditions that were being described for people who were suffering from long COVID. So I assume that using ME as an example, that there's been research and research projects happening in Scotland. So if you have these types of similarities, are you able to use previous research? I mean, how do you go about that in the sense that you've got, like, nurses, people working in the NHS right now that are being laid off? They're looking for an immediate response. Are you able to look at other conditions and give advice? Could I ask maybe Dr. Scott, I think, is online.
Hello.
Hi.
Yes, thanks. You can definitely draw from other post-viral conditions. I started advising the WHO on long COVID in about April 2020 because I'd been working with them for the previous 5 years on post-Ebola syndrome. I also treat chronic fatigue syndrome patients, but that wasn't my particular area. And every virus, every post-viral condition is slightly different, but they have their similarities, and the challenges that we faced in terms of getting clinical care at all, in terms of getting dedicated clinics, and in terms of leveraging research for Ebola patients or post-Ebola patients, were quite similar to what has been faced by our long COVID patients. The sort of stigma, gaslighting. People said that they were just feeling unwell because life is hard in West Africa, which our research has shown that actually what they're suffering from is persistent virus. So what we didn't get with post-Ebola syndrome was the research continued on to the important parts of understanding the underlying etiology and getting treatment. Because what happens at the end of every epidemic is the research funding moves on to the next pandemic. It happened with SARS, it happened with Ebola, all the money went subsequently into Zika. And we know when money goes into research during a pandemic that money will then move on when people stop being quite as scared of the disease itself. And that, it seems to me, is what's happening with COVID at the moment. However, we can draw from our previous experience and try to do two things. First of all, move things forward from where we were with the last disease. And second of all, do better the next time something new comes along. So we have to start research on survivors or long haulers, whatever you want to call them, at the beginning of outbreaks, not 6 months in or at the end of outbreaks. And we have to learn to provide adequate clinical care at the same time as characterising research. And I'm afraid I'm not convinced that that second part has happened in Scotland. We've got some excellent rehabilitation facilities, but it's mostly virtual and we don't have long COVID clinics. And as well as being a very difficult position from a clinical perspective, not seeing patients face to face with difficult multi-organ disease, that is making it more difficult to participate in the broader clinical trials and research that has been funded throughout the UK. So, for example, there is a platform for drug trials in long COVID. It's called Stimulate CP. It's led out of Imperial College. But it's running through the long COVID clinics in England. We will try to bring it up to the Highlands, but that is a big ask when we don't have a face-to-face clinical service. We have the locomotion study, which is potentially a UK-wide study looking at different provision of care. But the really more proactive arms of that, like testing exactly which interventions are useful, exactly what tests do with patients in clinic, what is useful, what is not useful, we are not really able to participate in to the same extent as our English colleagues, again, because of the lack of face-to-face clinics. So we've done a great job in Scotland in the linkage studies, and I'm a co-investigator on the long COVID study led by Jill Pell, and I think that has been a really amazing exercise, good big data. We're able to talk about things like what is the true prevalence, what's the impact of vaccination, and what's the natural history, which is all fabulous. But when it comes down to what do you actually do with a patient in clinic, do you do a sit-to-stand test? Do you do a lean test? Is it useful to screen for cardiac myopathy, such as came out of Colin Berry's study in Glasgow? Does everybody need screened, or is it just those with symptoms? Those are the sorts of questions that we need to think about on a practical level. And we aren't really doing that in Scotland because we're trying to treat everybody at a distance. We're just using their GP records or their numbers, or we're trying to do linkage. And that is very cost-effective research. But at some point, we have to develop experts in long COVID. And that means actually seeing the patients so we can come up with the right studies and the right questions to move things from characterising, which is what we did in 2020, onto, as Professor Domenicek says, understanding the underlying etiology and then providing proper management strategies and treatments.
Thank you. That's very helpful. That's my time up, convener.
Ask a quick question, just something you just said there, Dr. Scott, regarding the Stimulate CP, which I haven't heard of before, and it's being rolled out down in England. Is it being rolled out in Wales? Because I know that Wales has got a very similar approach to the way that Scotland's currently doing it.
Well, it's open to investigators right across the UK, but so far they haven't really stretched further north than, I think, about Manchester. So I am in discussions with them. If we can get a site in Inverness, we'll certainly broaden their geographic spread. But as I said, that there are some challenges involved with that. So their remit is across the UK, but in practice, it's mostly recruiting in England and around southern England at that.
At the moment. OK, thanks very much. If I can move on to Brian Whittle, please.
Thank you, Kavina. Good morning to the panel. My interest really in health has been around gathering of data and deployment of data, and do we have a system that actually allows effective deployment of data? I guess what I'm looking at here is in practice, we gather data. Do we have a system that allows that data to be crunched and deployed? And the effectiveness would be measured in how we ends up as treatment to patients. And to date, We've heard from both clinicians and from long sufferers of long COVID that investigation, that data, is not allowing an effective treatment at the front line. So I guess, Professor Robertson, I would come to you, given as a statistician and as a non-clinician. Is that right? So I'd come to you. So do we have an IT system in Scotland that allows that proper deployment of data and sharing of data across the whole system?
Well, I think the answer is yes and no. It has been feasible, and the large EVE study that I worked on has data from the health records and GP from pretty well everybody in Scotland. The permissions that we had to adopt in order to get access to that data involved negotiations with the GPs, who were very, very helpful in the beginning of the pandemic, because they realised the importance of the data. But the ethical and governance permissions meant that we weren't allowed to interrogate the GP data itself. What we had to do was to pre-specify clinical risk groups that would be important and vaccination data. And then, having pre-specified that amount of data, we were then able to extract it and move it into Public Health Scotland for the surveillance and vaccine effect studies during the pandemic. And also, a copy of the data went into the IDRIS platform for other researchers to access it in that way. So that worked. It was kind of a rolling static extract, because we got repeated extracts through Albasoft off the GP data. And once it's there, because we've got the Community Health Index number in Scotland, we can link it to all the other data that's available. So it gives Scotland a phenomenal research resource, not just for research, but for management and surveillance of not just COVID, but almost any other disease in Scotland. There's recent change, and I'm not an expert in this, but there are recent changes to move all of the GP data, which used to reside in all of the individual GP practices. It's now going onto a cloud-based server. NSS in Scotland is getting a copy of that, and there are moves afoot for permissions for all researchers and all or Public Health Scotland different groups to access that data. And when that is in place, it will be a phenomenal resource for Scotland. But there are others around who are have got more understanding of the exact details of that. But
okay, thank you. If I broaden it out to yourself, Ewan, in that gathering of data is, you know, we've always heard that Scotland's fantastic at gathering data. We have a phenomenal, but our ability to deploy that data in the practicalities, which will be how do we inform our GPs at the front line, you know, what to look for in COVID, and then how do we deploy some sort of resource to help patients at the front line, is not good. That's what we're hearing just now. That element is not good. So where are we with that? And what do we need to do to ensure that our healthcare professionals, you know, are properly informed about the issues around long COVID? I mean, we even heard some of them still don't believe in long COVID, and there's a mental, you know, they feel as that there's a mental health issue around long COVID, and the reality is, you know, long COVID exists. So how are we going to get to a point where we can, all this gathering of data is available to our healthcare professionals so that they can deploy that kind of resource?
Super. Thanks for that question. So the Chief Scientist's Office works within research, development and innovation area of the NHS, so our focus is on the use of data for research, development and innovation rather than the use of data for more operational reasons. So unfortunately, I won't be able to address operational elements of your question, but I'd be happy to take that back to the office, back to the Scottish Government, and have my colleagues answer that, if that would be helpful. But from a research perspective, we do put mechanisms in place to help researchers use the data at a national level. I think Chris mentioned one of the projects that has happened, that has been funded through the CSO, that has done that on GP data very successfully. But we do have a range of data safe havens across Scotland, a national one and regional ones, and their role is to pull together data to to allow it to be used in research projects, and they do that on a bespoke basis when research projects come forward and require that data. I think all of us recognise that we want that to be more efficient and effective in the future, and we continue to work to make that happen.
Yeah, I think you kind of led me into, I don't know if somebody else on the panel can help me with this, because at the end of the day, as I said, the quality of research in Scotland is world renowned. But in the end, it's how you deploy that in an effective way at ground level. And I think, I don't know if there's anybody else in the panel can help me with that, of how that, I'm looking at you, Dr. Scott, that can maybe help me at how that data is being deployed to help patients, because at the end, that's what we're trying to do. Dr. Scott?
That's part of my role here in the Highlands. I have two sessions for research and one session for clinical long COVID. We are covering a huge geographical area, so the only way we can do that is to work in close collaboration with our GP colleagues. So as part of the long COVID service, we're planning education and outreach with the GPs and with other clinicians, the allied health professionals, physiotherapists, occupational therapists, so forth. So my job is to keep on top of all this research and to transmit it into clinical practice, both in my own clinical practice, but also helping to disseminate that to my colleagues. Okay. I hope that works. But I only started yesterday, so I'll tell you in a few months.
that seems fair. That seems fair. Professor Anna, I think if we hear what Dr. Scott said there and how that information is now being deployed, how are we ensuring that good clinical practice or that good practice is being reflected across the whole of the NHS boards? Because for sure what we're hearing is it's patchy, and there is a bit of a postcode lottery in terms of whether you can access any kind of treatment for long COVID, let alone diagnosis. So how are we ensuring that is being deployed across the whole of the country?
Yeah. So just coming back to data for a minute, outside of my activity within Chief Scientist's Office, which is all dedicated to research, development and innovation, I also engaged in a pandemic preparedness group that looks at precisely what you said, data to be ready to deploy across the system in case there is another emergency. But of course, it has to be deployed every day in a normal practice to be useful. So we're looking at it, as my colleagues said, there are safe havens, both regional and central Scottish safe haven through the Public Health Scotland. And there is enormous effort from all colleagues across Scottish Government, NHS and everywhere else to make data useful for research, innovation, but also for everyday practice. This is absolutely crucial. And the issue, as we heard and as was recorded in previous sessions, is how long it takes from asking for a certain set of data to actually being able to use it. An ambition would be, but we're not there yet, to do it in 2 or 3 weeks. Yes?
Yeah. If I could just finally finish off, I was interested to hear you say, Professor Anna, around if you've got access to 5.1 million Scots, and that's obviously a significant pool of data that you can pull, but for that to be useful, people would have to, one, suspect they had long COVID or know they had long COVID. They'd have to then access a GP to be diagnosed, or at least a GP to signpost them somewhere that can be diagnosed for long COVID, and then they'd have to be able to identify a treatment. So I'm really interested in how, when you talk about 5.1 million people, the research that we've done and the evidence that we've taken suggests, especially in the more deprived areas, that people coming forward knowing that they potentially have long COVID is a problem.
So my colleague on far right did it, so he'll tell you better, but I looked at the paper that was published. In fact, it's available to look at today. And this EVE2 paper used more than a diagnosis. It used the words in GP computer to evaluate whether this might be long COVID. So there was more than a diagnosis made. Mm. There were other ways to look at this 5.1 million people. I would like my colleague, who is an expert, to describe this. I think this is a huge achievement. Mm. So yes, there is always a problem that if a patient didn't have any contact with health service, none, never came, never complained, then there are no data to look at. But majority of people with that plethora of symptoms that we see with long COVID mm-hmm. would have had some contact with GP, at least described series of symptoms that would allow to identify this might be long COVID. I think we need to hear from expert.
Yeah, so the 5.1 million is just really the adult population in Scotland. And the study that we looked in detail at the health records of about 500,000 people who tested positive, the same as Jill Scott's study, and then matched up records of these people who had at least had COVID at some time in the period with people who had tested but didn't have COVID at the time. And then you're comparing their contacts with the GPs in the periods 4 to 12 weeks or 12 to 26 weeks after their COVID. And that identified symptoms that were not necessarily recorded in the GP coding as long COVID, because that there is a code that the GPs can use, but they don't use it very often. But what you do find is that there people are being treated or reporting symptoms of fatigue. They're also reporting mental health issues. And there were a number of other symptoms that were much more common amongst those people who we know had tested positive for COVID mm-hmm. compared to people who we know had tested but didn't have it. So that gives you an idea of the symptoms that people are reporting. And there's also GPs are recording, are asking the people to go for further tests, like blood tests, echocardiographs, something else. Yeah. It shows my lack of medical knowledge. And also prescriptions, so things like for antibiotic prescriptions and stuff like that. Mm. So with these groupings of conditions, we're able to postulate that perhaps long COVID, a person with long COVID has had a test and has two or three of these types of interactions with the GP. And that's where we had our estimate of what the prevalence of long COVID might be. But we recognise that this is going to be an underestimate, because there are going to be people who have got coronavirus, but they've actually never bothered to go to their GP. And this was, might be what you were referring to as lack of engagement in particular mm-hmm. communities, where if someone doesn't think the GP is going to treat them, there's no much point going to see the doctor there. So, but one of the things that we're going to expand on is, having got this working definition, we're now going to look to see whether we can identify what might predict whether somebody's got this condition, and then use it to try and see in the future, because testing for COVID has now really diminished, and to look to see with people who are presenting for these types of symptoms mm-hmm. will have these have symptoms commensurate with having long COVID.
Thank you, convener.
A time on hand, John.
Thanks very much. Thanks, convener. I think probably I was going to follow on some of the line of questioning that Brian Whittle was going for. So, I mean, we heard different evidence from down south as well. But so, is one of the problems that the GPs, some of the GPs are either not familiar with the codes, or they're, and that's why you're going through this free text. Can you just explain to us what free text actually is? Because I'm not a medic or a scientist or anything.
No, when you have a clinical consultation, there are within the GP systems, there's a facility for them to
to go through their computer and pick a code for what you're consulting with. So if you go there with a severe headache, then the GP will click on the code this person's consulting about a severe headache. So we get a little read code in Scotland, and that's the great stuff for us to use as researchers. But alongside that, the GP will type in notes that say severe headache, and then, you know, something like, you know, maybe reports falling down 2 weeks ago or whatever. And then you might do query concussion and stuff like that. So the free text is everything else that the doctor writes in their notes at that time.
Okay.
So what we've found is that amongst people who had got... So the long COVID code was not used very often, but quite often in the free text, the doctor would write query long COVID,
right,
or COVID positive a while ago. So we're using that in other... and that was particularly in the fit for work notes that are also free text there. So that gives you an idea.
I mean, I have to say, I found your report paper very interesting. Yeah. Some of it I didn't understand, I confess, but it was good. I mean, can I press you? What is the prevalence of long COVID? I mean, I saw 1.8% yeah, gets mentioned in your paper, which would be maybe 90,000 people.
Yeah, that's what we estimated it as at that particular time. But other surveys will have looked at things differently. And I think Jill Scott's one has about 3 to 5%. Their areas are there because they're doing things in a slightly different way.
Right, I'll come to Dr. Scott next.
But that was our way. And we think that, as I explained, it's likely to be an underestimate because if someone doesn't go to the GP, they're not going to feature in our estimate of
yes,
prevalence.
So the kind of commonly used figure is about 170,000, I think. Is that a figure you feel would be a reasonable figure if you're underestimating?
Well, I know I'm underestimating. I don't know how
you don't know
much.
How much.
Underestimating. I mean, it just was, as statisticians, we're incredibly cautious about the biases, okay, that might exist in our data.
No, that's fair. That's what I want to hear. I'm just, I will come to Dr. Scott. Just final one, though, for yourself. I was interested that more of the long COVID seems to have come from Alpha and Delta and less from Omicron. Is that what you found?
That's what we found, yes. But again, there's another potential bias, but although we think we corrected for this, is that Omicron is around just now. But Omicron is also around at a time when people are heavily vaccinated. And I know that the Jill study looked at the impact of vaccination on whether or not individuals develop long COVID as well.
Okay, well, I think Dr. Scott's going to come in now. There's a question for you, Dr. Scott, anyway. So go ahead on what we've asked already.
So I'm a co-investigator on Professor Jill Pell's leading the study, the long COVID study, and I'm one of the co-investigators. We've got one paper that's already been published looking at some of the natural history of long COVID. And yes, we've got one about to come out on true prevalence. So again, the way that the long COVID, the COVID in Scotland study worked is it sent out text prompts to everybody who tested positive and got back feedback from patients with, I think in our next study, it's about just over 41,000 positive cases and with a control group of 35,000 who were tested but found to be negative. So this isn't published data yet, but our true prevalence estimates are looking at somewhere between 6 and 10% of people who tested positive for COVID. That's not a population estimate, that's a proportion of people who test positive. The ONS data, which again, they've done things in a very different way, they have an estimate of about 2.2 to 3% of the population. It doesn't matter which way you cut it, we're talking a lot of people. 3% of the population, 1.6, there are a lot of people out there with a large range of disease.
Okay, thank you. Now, you were quite keen on long COVID clinics, and we've had, I think it would be fair to say, mixed evidence about long COVID clinics. For example, that they're extremely costly per patient, and that people with other conditions might be diverted away from GPs to the long COVID clinics, and so things would be missed. I mean, I just wonder, is it not the GPs in all of this that are key? Because I think even in England, the GPs refer people to the long COVID clinics? So the GPs are the key people?
Yes, I think GPs are pretty key in our healthcare system across the board, really, not just in long COVID. The English clinics, as I understand, take referrals from general practice. The Welsh are accepting direct referrals. But I think probably if you had a long COVID clinic, it would be on referral from GPs. For the post-Ebola syndrome, we took referrals from the Ebola treatment units and directly from individuals. But that's because there was such stigma associated with Ebola that they were not able to even go into their local healthcare providers at all. So I think it's a testable hypothesis. Does a secondary care doctor add value to a patient outcome? That's exactly the sort of thing that health systems research could look at, that the locomotion study could look at. I've only had one multidisciplinary team meeting with the long COVID team here in Inverness, but in that one meeting, the team has highlighted four individuals with complex disease, three of which I think would need a secondary care outpatient appointment, and one will probably need admitted. And it's not clear if all of what they have is long COVID or something else. You have to rewind and be a bit of a general physician. And I think that's where secondary care can come in. There's a range of disease which is long COVID, a range of symptoms. And some of it can be self-managed. Some of it could be managed in primary care. And some of it, I think, will need a face-to-face secondary care clinic. We do have to be a bit pragmatic about it, I think.
The point about face-to-face meeting with people, is that something that varies around the different health boards within Scotland, that some would be doing more face-to-face than others, or is that a national problem?
I don't know of anybody who is funded to do a face-to-face long COVID clinic. There's one private GP, I think, who's given evidence to this inquiry, who's got a very good reputation. I know of a few other colleagues who are seeing people on a bit of an ad hoc basis in other clinics. But other than that, I don't think there's anything on the scale of the English long COVID clinics. I mean, I would say in Highlands, we've got other issues as well that could also do with rehab. We have Lyme disease, quite a lot of Lyme disease up here as well. I wouldn't want to miss those patients out of any service. You know, we just have to be a bit equitable about what we're offering and try to target it at people with whom we can make a difference to their care.
Yeah, well, that's an interesting one to bring in. As a hill walker, I always am a bit wary of Lyme disease. Could I move to Professor Duncan and Professor Cooper? On the question of GPs, I think your paper also suggested maybe, you know, GPs are reacting differently to long COVID. Some of them are maybe wary of diagnosing. Is that the case?
Yeah, so we have, and again, we should say our findings are initial findings and haven't been peer reviewed and published yet.
Yeah, I was going to ask you what your timescale for that would be.
Yeah, so we're currently analysing that data and in the process of putting papers together, so they should be out in the public domain soon. But we have, in the course of our research over the past almost couple of years, we've interviewed people with long COVID who have varied experiences of accessing, some very positive experiences of accessing GPs who are very helpful, did lots of tests. Sometimes the difficulty there in some of the health boards was not knowing where the person should then be referred to because of sometimes the time or the knowledge around services that were available for the patients, like rehabilitation services, and some examples where it's not been so helpful. So a bit of a kind of mixed picture, I think, would be fair to say. We also have interviewed some GPs, and that's the data I'm not so familiar with. Do you want to answer that piece, Eddie?
So to answer your question, there's been a mix of responses. So some GPs have been very, very supportive of patients who... So looking at the patient data and the GP data and bringing these two stories together and matching it up, our data suggests that some GPs are very responsive and very willing to send people for tests and follow people up. Some GPs suggested that they view the condition as something which will resolve naturally over time and does not need intervention. And some GPs and some patient data report that their GPs don't believe, in inverted commas, in long COVID. So there's a mix. Now, I can't give proportions to those, and I'm not suggesting by any manner means that all GPs are like that, but you do see that breadth of perspective in the data that we've got. I think the other thing to say, which speaks to our data as well, is the, whilst not wanting to say whether or not, not able to say whether or not specialist versus non-specialist clinics are right or wrong, our evaluation method is a bit more nuanced than that. It uses a methodology called realist evaluation, which asks the question, what works for who, in what situations and when? Because obviously the people of Scotland live in dramatically different situations. There's people in the Highlands and Islands communities, and there are people in big urban cities. And the availability or the opportunity to develop services varies dramatically across these systems. In our four case studies that we're looking at, which looks at varying different health boards and different types of settings, in the two health boards which at different times had had, from a rehabilitation perspective, not with medical expert input, but from a rehab perspective, the closest you could come to call a long COVID specialist clinic, what's clearly been useful is the promotion of accessible pathways to access those care. So actively publicising both to GPs and to patients how to access these services. And where that happens, you see a massive influx of people coming for care. Where that doesn't happen, where that's not available, the numbers of people that come through into secondary services, into the rehabilitation professionals who are delivering integrated long COVID rehab, those numbers are very, very small, and it's quite stark.
OK, I think I'm going to have to stop it there. I've used up my time, but thanks very much for that. We could explore it further. Thanks, convener.
Much. Can I bring in Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you very much, convener. Thanks very much for coming. I'm going to kind of try and mop up a wee bit here, but I'm going to come back to yourselves first about the reaction from GPs. It sounds very similar to the reaction from GPs to women who go in for menopause. Some doctors say, you'll get over it, it's just change your life. Others say, let's take this seriously and go through a whole process. Who monitors the GP's reaction to a patient going in to say, I have a problem? And is there any recourse for a patient who says, my doctor just isn't taking this seriously?
I don't think, from we're not primary care specialists, I'm afraid. I don't feel that we would be in an evidence-based position to answer that question.
Okay, so it was just a thought that came to my head while you were giving that. Do you feel that there's enough connectedness to all the research that's going on that feeds back into the system for practitioners to actually use? So everything that you guys are all doing, is that getting to the guys that are actually seeing people in a waiting room?
Yeah.
Anna?
I think our system for all diseases, and particularly here, is very well designed to inform. Of course, every research project aims, and this is very, very clear to researchers, to publish peer review paper, which then feeds into the guidelines. And as you know, this particular condition has unusual guidelines, where SIGN guidelines, Scottish guidelines, combined with NICE and the Royal College of General Practitioners. I think this is the only, to my knowledge, the only such situation where actively all research is monitored to input to these guidelines as quickly as possible. So there was the recent edition, I think, in 21, and probably something will happen soon again with newer guidelines. Okay. In addition, all researchers, those funded by CSO and everybody else, participates in national and international meetings and symposia, and these 9 projects funded by CSO came together to present preliminary data at the symposium some months ago. So there is a huge effort to make data, everything that comes out of this research, available. Final reports will be published, of course, when ready, published in a language that will be accessible, the effort is made. And in addition, there is UK-wide system of reporting all research results through so-called FISH system, So this is all reported for posterity and available for searching, looking at, etc.
Okay, thank you. Professor Robertson, can I come to you for a wee second? Did you say that the data that you were looking at, did you try to disseminate whether or not people were more likely to get long COVID if they had been vaccinated as opposed to if they hadn't been vaccinated?
We have not looked at that in detail. There's a table in there which suggests that long COVID was more common amongst people who were unvaccinated at the time they got coronavirus.
Is there a correlation between the fact that they were unvaccinated, or was it the strain of the virus that they caught? Are you able to disseminate that?
At the present time, I won't say yes or no. The two things are confounded in the way that the unvaccinated largely got coronavirus when the wild type and alpha was around.
Right.
The vaccinated who got coronavirus were largely in the Delta and Omicron period.
Okay. Sorry, Janet Scott, my apologies, I forgot your name for a second there. How do you feel we're doing in the country right now? And I'm going to come back to the point of view, if I'm a patient with long COVID and I'm going to my GP, how do you feel we're doing right now as a country and actually getting those people into the right pathway?
I think it's pretty dreadful.
How do we sort it?
Okay.
Maybe we should have started with that question right at the beginning.
I think my colleagues there in health systems research hit the nail on the head. We have to have clear and well-publicised pathways. Now, however we choose to do that, if that's through primary care or with a combination of primary and secondary care, there has to be a clear way. At the moment, some of the services, we don't have a lot of funding for a large geographical area here in the Highlands, so there is some reticence to really go out and publicise things, because we already have quite a backlog of people to see, and we are aware of the huge unmet need out there, and we know that if we properly publicise things, that there will be a deluge that we are not equipped to cope with. So I think we've got people sitting at home needing care, and we don't have the pathways there to deal with it. So we need to make sure that those pathways actually exist, that if a patient needs self-care, that they can access those facilities. If they need face-to-face physiotherapy or OT, that they can access those facilities. If they need a secondary care advocate or a general physician, that yes, you can actually access that. And then we need to publicise it. So we don't want to publicise what doesn't exist. And at the moment, we don't have a clinic to see those patients that need them. We don't have a face-to-face physio to give those patients who need it. Now, whether or not, I think the need is there. You know, we're hearing that from patients all the time. And it's not that every patient with long COVID needs all of that service any more than every patient with COPD needs to come into hospital, you know, three times a year. But some patients with COPD do need that. And some patients with long COVID do need secondary care. And you need somebody to advocate to make sure that they get seen by a POTS expert or seen by an endocrine expert or assessed in terms of of mast cell activation or whatever it is we're going to do, and so that we can optimise everybody's health. So I don't think we have the structures in place clinically, and those structures we have, we are being loath to advertise. This session is about research. I also want to add that I do think that is hampering our participation in national and international research.
Okay, thank you very much. Edward, I'm going to ask you one very quick question. Did your research find anything re-single point of contact, and if that was desirable? Edward.
Oh,
sorry.
Sorry, I wasn't sure who you...
We didn't specifically study single point of contact research. Single point of contact. That's an intervention which comes out, or a service which has come out since our study has started, as part of the long COVID funding. So it's not something specific to our study.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. If I just may ask a few quick questions. I know we've just run it. We're just a bit over time, but could I ask about the international and I know it was just mentioned regarding how is the international research in long COVID being disseminated in Scotland? I don't know, Dr. Scott, did you want to come in here? I don't know that you just mentioned that.
Well, as with all research, it's available through the preprints, it's available through the published press, but you do have to have time to sift through all of that and keep active. And, you know, each particular GP has a big workload and long COVID isn't necessarily their main focus of attention. So that's where it's useful to have specialists in a particular area to get to know patients properly clinically, get to be an expert in this area. And then it's your job to keep up with the literature and to keep up with the regular research, international or local. I mean, I also see HIV patients. I don't expect every GP to keep up with all the HIV literature, but as an infectious disease physician, that's part of my job. And I'm not sure that it has to be part of every GP's job to keep up with all of the long COVID literature. It's part of, you know, more specialist people to keep up with that, sift through it and provide appropriate guidance out to primary care.
Thank you, Dr. Scott. Thank you. And Ewan Dick, if I could just come to you regarding, because this is specifically about funding and research moving forward, what level of research funding for long COVID is needed in the short to medium term, in your personal opinion?
Thank you. I don't think we'll be able to give a figure for that. As we said earlier in our response, I think we're at the next stage of doing research around low COVID. And as we've mentioned earlier, we've opened our committees, and the committees across our colleagues across the UK have opened their committees for proposals to come forward from the expert community to propose what they want to do in future research. So they have access to the funds that are available across a whole range of conditions. And once those proposals come forward, they'll be put forward in front of scientific committees in order to give the expert advice as to what we should be funding going forward and what would be of most value for us.
That's great. Thank you very much. If I can ask, and I'm going to open this up to any of the witnesses, if they could perhaps just raise their hands and they'll let me know, because it's difficult for me to see online. Are any of the witnesses today aware of any additional or ongoing funding streams for long COVID research? That could be utilised? Dr. Scott?
We've not mentioned the Wellcome Trust, and there are international funding. I mean, we all go for any money that's available. I don't think any of us are very proud about that. So there's national and international money, and wherever it comes from is where we'll apply and get it. So those fundings are not specific to long COVID, but there are they're available to all diseases. You just have to put the case and argue your point.
Could I add to this, Chair?
Yes.
I absolutely agree. And I think, as we said before, we encourage clinician scientists, public health researchers across Scotland to go for any possible funding, and we bring information closer, etc. We haven't mentioned Horizon yet, which is a big, big issue. As you know, our scientists currently could apply for Horizon funding, and it is covered by UKRI in the meantime. We don't know what's going to happen long term, but this is a perfect condition for large coordinated international consortia to do research. And I hope Horizon is going to happen. This funding will come to Scotland, and then there will be opportunity for colleagues across Scotland to apply for big international agreed funding streams that could answer some of the things we've been discussing today.
Thank you very much. If I could just stay with you, Dame Anna, just one last question. What oversight has there been on how research funding across the UK has been allocated?
So we work closely with colleagues across four nations. There are a number of ways we discuss what we do, but there are oversight groups such as OSCAR, where funders of clinical and public health research come together. We discuss things bilaterally with UKRI, Medical Research Council, major charities, including Wellcome. But as we said before, all these bodies, including National Institute for Health and Care Research, all these bodies, like the CSO, do have their own expert committees. And there would be normally an open call. The proposals come depending on the size of the given call and proposals. There could be two stages, an early stage and then full proposal, so expression of interest, full proposal. And this will always be independently assessed by experts in the area. So as the colleague online said, it is important to have experts in long COVID to be able to assess these proposals. But we believe, and there is enormous evidence, that open calls produce the best possible research. And the expert assessment is what we need. There is something called Haldane principle, that we shouldn't dictate to scientists what to research. There should always be peer review of experts, because that produces much better research for our patients.
Thank you very much, Dame Anna. That's very helpful. Can I thank all the witnesses for giving their evidence and giving us all your time this morning? If any witness would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you on how to do that. The committee's next meeting will be the 16th of March, when we will conclude our long COVID inquiry with the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and for the meeting to move into private. Thank you very much, everybody.